Hi, my name is Eric Rios-Doria. I'm a GYN Oncology Fellow here at the University of Washington and Fred Hutch Cancer Center. I've been here a fellow now for 3 years, and we are a four-year training program. September is Gynecologic Cancer Awareness Month, and this is a national and really an international movement to create greater awareness for patients, to be really aware of these five gynecologic cancers and to know the symptoms. If they're having any concerns, to seek care with their medical team. So there are five different types of gynecologic cancers that relate to the gynecologic organ system, and that is cancer of the uterus, cancer of the cervix, cancer of the ovaries, the vulva, and the vagina. And when we talk about uterine cancer, we also refer to endometrial cancer or falling within that realm, depending on the origin of that cancer, but overall we're referring to the organ of the uterus. And with ovarian cancer, you can think of that as an umbrella term because cancers of the fallopian tube or primary peritoneal cancer are all treated in the same paradigm as ovarian cancer. So there's different risk factors for every single gynecologic cancer. Some risk factors do not change, such as age, race, health history, and genes, but overall maintaining a healthy lifestyle reduces your risk in your lifetime to develop these types of cancers. And so it's very important for patients to have that type of guidance and to know that. If we go through all of them within uterine cancer, a lot of them are lifestyle risk factors, and that includes things such as diabetes, hypertension, and obesity. We know also that patients who have not had any bearing of children or have started their cycles at an early age or late menopause are also at higher risk of developing more common types of endometrial cancer. There's also an inherited familial form of this, and so patients who have family history of endometrial cancer or colon cancer are also at a high risk of this. Within ovarian cancer, the risk increases with age. That is the primary risk factor for that. Patients who have a family history of ovarian cancer, peritoneal cancer, fallopian tube cancer, or premenopausal breast cancer, or even if patients themselves have a personal history of premenopausal breast cancer, they are at higher risk for developing that type of cancer. Patients who also have a history of infertility, patients who have not had any bearing of children, and also if they are of Ashkenazi Jewish heritage can be at a higher risk of that type of cancer. Within cervical cancer, we know that it is most commonly caused by HPV, or the human papillomavirus. This is a virus that has many different types of strains. Some are more aggressive than others. And we are exposed to HPV pretty commonly, but our bodies are strong enough and resilient to fight off that type of virus. However, when we become immunosuppressed, that is when the chronic and long-standing infections of HPV can linger and lead to these types of cancers. So things such as smoking can cause immune suppression in the body and lead to that type of cancer. This also affects vaginal and vulvar cancer, with HPV being a leading cause of that as well. There's also some skin conditions of the vulva, something called lichen sclerosis, that can put patients at a higher risk of developing that type of cancer. There are a lot of different risk factors for each individual gynecologic cancer, but I think the most important things for patients to realize are the risk factors and when they should be getting assessed by their medical team for this type of issue. The most important thing is for patients to be really in tune with their body and be aware of the symptoms. Unfortunately, for gynecologic cancers, unlike things like colon cancer or breast cancer, where there are screening tests, we don't have any screening tests for the majority of GYN cancers. I'll start with the one that we do, and that is cervical cancer. We have a very great screening test, and that is the pap smear, which is done periodically beginning at age 21 or earlier in certain medical conditions or scenarios. But for the majority of the population, beginning at age 21 is when pap smears are begun. This is a preventative screening test that ensures that the cells on the cervix are normal, and if they are abnormal, further workup is done thereafter. So within cervical cancer, we know that HPV can lead to this type of cancer evolving, and the HPV vaccine has been around for a very long time and is preventative of the higher strains, more aggressive strains of HPV, and can reduce the risk of cervical cancer. Within uterine cancer, as I said, there are no screening tests for that, but one of the main symptoms that is concerning and that leads to a workup for this is abnormal bleeding. That can happen really at any age and should be thoroughly worked up at any age, but specifically in the postmenopausal setting, postmenopausal bleeding is not normal and is not okay and should be assessed as soon as possible by the medical team. For ovarian cancer, it's hard because there are a constellation of symptoms, and some of them can be nonspecific and cross over with other conditions of the body. But when there's a constellation of symptoms that include abdominal pain, abdominal bloating, or abdominal cramping, feeling full earlier with meals, changes in the urinary habits, changes in the bowel habits, or just general fatigue, alone those symptoms don't mean that there is ovarian cancer present, but when these constellation of symptoms are present and persistently there, it could indicate that something else is going on, and ovarian cancer is on the differential for that. So there are certain gynecologic conditions that put you at a higher risk for this over a course of a lifetime. As you mentioned, endometriosis can be associated with certain ovarian types of cancers, which again falls under the umbrella of ovarian cancer, fallopian tube cancer, and primary peritoneal cancer. Patients with polycystic ovarian syndrome, those patients are also at a higher risk of things mainly endometrial cancer or uterine cancer. So patients that are diagnosed with breast cancer, and especially in the premenopausal setting, should be screened for inherited breast and ovarian cancer syndrome, and that would detect if there is a genetic change within their bodies that could indicate that they would be at a higher risk for ovarian cancer. Terms such as BRCA1 or BRCA2 or BRCA1, BRCA2, these are some common genes that are have some mutations that can put a patient at a higher risk for breast cancer and ovarian cancer. And so if a patient has breast cancer, they should have a genetic testing that would confirm if there is any higher risk of ovarian cancer developing or not.